Sure, I don't see why not. We don't run to a full-time ME here, so we use Dr. McKenzie. She works out of a clinic on the other side of town. I'll call her and tell her to expect you. She looked at her watch. Probably best if you swing by tomorrow. She'll probably have left her office by now. Nightingale booked himself into the Paradise Motel, about a mile down the road from the police station. It was far from Paradise, but it was clean and comfortable, and they served a half-decent breakfast in the diner by the main entrance. The next morning he had eggs and toast and two cups of coffee before driving around to Dr. McKenzie's clinic. He identified himself at reception, and within minutes he was in the presence of Veronica J. McKenzie, M.D., a fact that was confirmed by the wooden plaque on her desk. Dr. McKenzie was tall and slim, wearing a tight olive T-shirt under a grey jacket. Her black hair was cut short, and her brown eyes shone with a fierce intelligence. Nightingale felt himself being weighed up as he sat down opposite her. She was wearing a wedding ring, and there was a framed photograph behind her of a husband and two young boys. Chris says you're investigating the death of Mr. Carson. I've been hired by Mr. Carson's daughter. She just wants to know what happened to her father. We'd all like to know that, said the doctor. It's a real mystery. I've never seen anything like it before. The cause of death is still unknown. Not at all. The cause of death is very obvious. Extreme trauma. Smashed all the major bones, ruptured almost every organ he had. Trouble is, there was nothing that could have caused it. No fall, no train, no truck, no steam hammer. The only time I ever saw anything like it was when I worked in Chicago years ago in a hospital. A guy jumped in front of a train. But of course that's not possible here. So do you have a theory? The doctor shrugged.